I'm very honored to be here talking to you lovely audience. We've been having great 1.5 days so far, and I'm sure the rest of the show is going to be great as well. So let's get started. May I request you to get disarmed now? What I mean is, this smart device is actually capable of destroying our attention. And let me tell you why. Because we are the so-called users. Users. That word itself somehow makes me feel there is no emotion or sort of mechanical. How about the word humans instead? When you switch on from users to humans, I think there is a little bit of empathy that comes to you from within yourself, and you start feeling that you are part of this holistic creation, that you are part of called humanity. That visual is not showing up here. That's my bad in design. There's a gray over human there, user there. So put humans at the core of your UX thought, not just users. So get adapted to this new word, humans. The reason is, and it's just as simple as moving from you to hedge. That was always there. So it's not UX anymore, it's more of human experience. How do we measure really product success these days? What are our contemporary yardstick to just measure, is a product successful or not? We check how much money is being made. We check how many users are converted. What does the social media say? And the number of downloads, reviews, and ratings. This defines whether a product is successful or not. Well, in a way, we are telling users are commodity. The more users you have, the more you can sell. Make a product, acquire users, get acquired by a good company, big valuation, you sold the users. I think if you empathize with the word users, I'm sure you'll feel that humans are not commodity. You might not want to do that with humans. Talking about empathy, which is essentially stepping into the shoe of someone else. So if you just step into your UX thought process and think, you're not designing for users, you're actually designing for humans, I'm sure you'll start treating them differently. So let's talk about human needs. Luckily, one of the speakers spoke about the Maslow's hierarchy of human needs. It helps me. So your physiological need, body, temperature, food, water, these are your physiological human needs. And then comes a sense of security wherein, am I safe? Am I healthy? Is my children safe? Is my family safe? Is my job safe? Am I safe economically and so on? Then comes the sense of belonging to a community, sense of love, and being part of this whole community, like we as UX folks. And then, if all these needs are met, then comes the self-esteem, your social status, your achievements, your career. And then, the self-actualization. Perhaps, I think most of the organizations would want their employees to be at this stage. Because this is a stage where you become highly creative, innovative, and you have a sense of purpose in life. So, I believe there is a gap. Big gap in empathy for humans. And so between your product and the humans, and the humans that you're designing for, I believe there's a gap. So if you use the Maslow's need, hierarchy of need, you'll see that, okay, where does this need actually settle? Where does it reside? It's here, in the human brain. We are born with billions of neurons, with very few connections initially, and then it's a great blessing, by the way. And then what happens? As we grow, the chart here, as we grow, the connections get improved. Everything we see, feel, hear, starts getting registered in our brains, neural pathways, as a new, unique connection. And these connections sometimes give you pleasurable experience, good experience. So these are tagged as good experience. And sometimes it gets tagged in your brain as bad experience. Luckily, there are some chemicals that get brewed in your brain when you have good experience. They are called happy brain chemicals. There are a couple of them that I will talk about. Dopamine and serotonin. Dopamine is when you get rewarded, or whenever you know you are going to get rewarded, your brain secretes this chemical. These are very recent discoveries by scientists, by the way. So, whenever you feel, so remember, the last time you updated something on Facebook, the number of likes you got, the number of comments you got, and that got you crazy. And you know next time when you are going to update, what to look forward for. That's dopamine. When you win a video game, you get dopamine. If you're looking for a parking and you got it, you get dopamine. And if an alcoholic guy sings a bar, he gets dopamine. So, dopamine is actually good. Serotonin, on the other hand, is more about self. So it's about being maybe obsessed with self, getting social dominance, and sort of narcissism. Together, they are the brain's happy chemicals. A lot of products these days know how to manipulate that in their product and actually get attention. Are there any game developers here? Game designers, developers? None. So they would know how to exploit these chemicals. A little bit of dopamine and serotonin is not harmful. They're actual natural brain chemicals. So they are useful, it's good. But when you start getting this in a very excessive level, what is called as dopamine surge, then there is a problem. So you start getting these dopamine loops, that becomes choice. Choice are essentially a way of forcefully drawing your attention with the use of rapid change in visuals, audio, sometimes even comments, showing you a violent video and so on. I have a small video to play here that is intentionally created to create a lot of jolts. Damaging. And here is a man who can give you 900 jobs on this image, and if I put the audio and video, you can get it in hundreds, multiples of hundreds. So let's talk about some consequences of this. There are some negative consequences of this, and they are an impact on our attention. Try to remember, before all this came, I think we were all a little bit more focused in our work, in our studies. Even our kids were really happy to focus on studies, but these days it's so difficult to grab attention. Young people, brilliant minds, their talent is being wasted, glued to hours and hours of video gaming and social media. Everybody I meet for an interview has 500 plus friends in their Facebook group, literally, and these are freshers, right? So, kids are impacted. And what about we as adults? Sitting next to the spouse, talking to them physically, but then parallelly discussing with our friends in a WhatsApp group what's happening over the weekend. And this one is nice. Is there any Pokemon Go player here? Oh, okay. Some. Good. So let's measure the success of this product. They made $4 to $5 million on the first day. They acquired about 26 million users, and that number is growing every day. You know what the social media said? The first 10 million downloads happened in just the 13 hours of the product launch, and the ratings went viral. So no bet, that was a very successful product. Look at this man. Do you think he will remember when he had his last meal while playing Pokemon Go? Look at his security. He is in front of a metro track. Do you think people look at him? The only community is glued to his Pokemon Go, and people would look at him and say, he's out of mind. There's no self-esteem. And all his creative power is going only to catch that Pokemon monster. So I don't say making money is bad. I'm just saying that irresponsible design can be bad. And this is one of the negative consequences we talk about. So there's also something called as dark patterns. It's a way of making your UI, your interface, in such a way that users don't realize what they do things that they did not really intend to. Imagine you went to make a flight booking, and there was this insurance predict, this 100, 200 rupees, whatever. And you had to go and uncheck them. Otherwise, you end up paying. How many people do that? So that is one of the dark patterns. There's an organization called Dark Patterns Report that tracks these kind of things, and they name and shame some of the organizations that use this. And sometimes we are humans, so there's also anti-patterns, just pure human mistake. There are a few ladies. I hope you have seen the Miss Universe 2015 contest. No? Okay, here is what happened. Steve Harvey, one of the famous US host, TV host, he came to announce the winner. And he came and said, Miss Columbia is the winner. And then he has to come back a couple of minutes later after all the ovation and live telecast and says, guys, I have to apologize. And then he says, it was my bad. It was not Columbia, it was Philippines indeed who is the winner. Terrible mistake. Look at the card design, and look at how he's holding. It was not designed for human then. The vital information is taking only 5% of the space, and rest is just blank. So human errors can also be very disastrous. And look at the emotions that these women, she had to be ground, unground, and then the lady, female from Philippines had to be ground. So let's move on to talk about designers for a second. I think we are very powerful people. What comes with great power? Greater responsibility. Yeah? So, we influence the human life. Products today are digital. We design the products that people use in their daily lives. The clicks, the taps, the choices they make on screen, on all the devices. So therefore, use your power for the long-term human well-being, not just the short-term goal. Be motivated by the user acquisition alone. Think about the real human need. What will make you productive? What will make you smart in the long run? And still be human. So here are the takeaways quickly. Start with a good intent. Some brands like Apple, they still call it as human interface guidelines. They don't call it user interface guidelines. And this is why some of the people queue overnight to go and buy the products. And, you know, keep your approach very, very ethical. And I know this is very subjective, what can be ethical for me and what can be ethical for you. But then at least if you are cautious about this, I'm sure you'll do a good job. Think about the unintended consequences. Steve Harvey could have been saved that day. The design was better. And think about the kind of products you want our future generations to have. So they are humans too, so think about that. And fill them with the gap, strike out the word users, and think about the humans. And go ahead and impact. Impact by good design. And while you're designing for humans, do so very responsibly. Thank you.
I'm Sirajuddin, and my passion is fonts and languages. And like you said, the winner of the Miss World, Miss Universe. What happens today is any crucial decision taken by the end user or the customer is unable to read the conditions, terms, even in their LIC policies or in their bank documents. When you talk about space and usage, I think it is very vital in day-to-day life. I don't know how many of them in this hall really read before signing on any document.
99% don't, I'm sure.
Anybody reads
the terms and conditions of the banking documents, credit card documents, your airline ticket terms and conditions? How many? Show of hands, one?
Great, sir, great. So if you left off 1 rupee or 50 paisa in your credit card, you'll get a no to your loan because that 50 paisa or 1 rupee has become some 27,000 or 30,000 in varieties. Unless you clear that 20,000-30,000, you can't buy a car, you can't buy anything for it on loan. So it is not only the designer's duty to make people read. It is also people's duty to demand. Yes, I want this information to be available. Any document we sign, we are paying for the print job. And we can demand a cleared, very clear, readable documents. So I request as a designers, you insist, don't go by cheaper paper. You see very vital information like pesticide leaflet. There will be instructions in several languages. Of course, many of the farmers can't read, but still whosoever can read, they can't really read it.
And I think primarily because the product manufacturers thought these are secondary information.
But actually they are mandatory. They
correct,
are
secondary. I'm saying compliance is more or less seen as a secondary information or a not so commercially good thing.
Yeah, even I think that's what question. Mine is not a question, it's only a statement or my opinion on this.
Thank you. I think it goes in line with what I'm saying as well, that vital information should be bold and clear. It should be available to humans to read. If you give a 15-page agreement and people think that I don't have time to read it, I don't even understand that legal lawyer's language to sign. And obviously they're under hurry. So I agree with you. Thank you. Thank you. Any more? Thank you.